The camera does start on you if you're silent, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
I just had a sudden bolt of fear shot through when I realized that I could just be watching you dance with the amused expression on my face, and that would be the intro to the video.
No, the intro to the video is me silently dancing.
Okay, good.
If you call it dancing, I don't know.
Something approaching dancing.
Yeah, something. There's a sense that in my head there may be a rhythm playing. It's a rhythm that, as you know, as a white person, that I can dance to. I'm very, very much on that jerk, sort of smooth jazz. Oh my God, this music really speaks to me.
Yeah.
Anyway, welcome to the MMA Vivisection. I am Zane Simon, host of the Vivisection with my co-hosts, Connor Rebush, and we are here to talk about UFC Portland, which is a fun trash card. It's going to be pretty trashy.
Doesn't have the same innate appeal that last week's card did.
No, it really doesn't. There are some fights on this card that I look forward to being complete shit shows. They're even a couple surprising ones. There are a couple fights on this card where I looked at it and I'm breaking it down like, you know, this fight's going to be a huge fucking mess. So I'm excited to talk about that at the very least. We'll be giving you all the fight odds, breakdown, analysis, all that good stuff that we normally do. Yeah, do you have any other feelings about this card before we dive right into it?
Well, you know, it's an odd card because of the preliminaries. I'm kind of most excited about the light heavyweight bouts, both of which should be really fun. And you know it's a strange card when you can say that the 205-pounders promise to have some of the best action.
Yeah, it definitely. The 205ers and, frankly, the heavyweights, too. Like, sure, I'm actually looking forward to the heavyweight.
Which means I'm prepared to be disappointed because I have the best expectations for the biggest fighters on the card.
Yeah.
In size, not in popularity, and so that means like it's probably gonna suck a lot more than I think it will.
Yeah, this is not a good card. It's and you know, it's not even a card where I'm gonna be like, these are all gonna be action fights. This is all gonna be just like off the chain action, fun scraps. Even if they're not the highest level fights, they'll be fun. I cannot assure you that that is going to be the case. Some of these will be. Some of them could easily turn into three rounds of wall and stall cage grinding.
Yep.
Let's just dive right in with a woman's bantamweight bout, fight pass opener, Kelly Faszholz versus Ketlin Vieira.
Very difficult to get a read on a fight like this. Kelly Faszholz, even having seen her in the UFC, it's tough to really know more than just kind of the surface level aspects of her game. It's kind of tough to know like how good is her stamina really in a hard fought fight in which she's not really in control the whole time when she has a full camp behind her, because it definitely suffered against Lauren Murphy, but you know, that was a very tough debut for a young fighter on short notice. I guess she's not actually that young, is she? I think she's 30 or 31.
No, a lot of these women fighters that are getting into the UFC are not as young as we want them to be.
Ketlin Vieira is kind of similar to Faszholz in a lot of ways. Her record obviously looks better, but again, only on the surface. She really hasn't fought anybody of note. In fact, I think the only person of note that either of these women has fought is Lauren Murphy. Kelly Faszholz lost that fight. She did have her moments, though, and I think the fact that Vieira seems a little more willing to brawl makes me trust her less. Vieira, I have seen quite a few of her fights where she is just standing head-centered, swinging both hands, and kind of forcing her opponent into a clinch so she can drag them to the ground. Things get a little bit messier with her. I think she's used to overwhelming people. And Faszholz strikes me as a solid athlete. She's got a good frame for the kind of distance fighting that she likes to do. And Vieira is not really a phenomenal wrestler, and Faszholz didn't look altogether easy to take down in the Murphy fight. So I'm going to go with Kelly Faszholz by decision, but you know, probably the toughest one to call on the card just for lack of experience. Experience is good for us as analysts as well as for the fighters because we actually know what to expect.
Yeah, I gotta agree. I think the size Faszholz brings, and she seems like a reasonably decent competitive athlete who's now had a taste for fighting in the UFC. Vieira has leaned a lot on her size at lower levels, like Faszholz has. But I think she tends to be even like much more of a wild brawler. Like, it seems like Faszholz really likes to press an aggressive fight, and she might get tired doing it, but she really likes to lean on being aggressive and outworking someone. And Vieira seems to get drawn into an aggressive fight where she's not comfortable and is trying to find ways to stop being aggressive. Like, she's trying to make her opponent stop pressing her so she can go back to something more patient.
Yeah.
And I think that is going to really be good for Faszholz. But, you know, these are two pretty decent-sized 135-pounders who tend to brawl a bit, so...
Both without a ton of meaningful experience, so...
Yeah, both without much meaningful experience. So this fight really could go anywhere, look like anything in the end. I'm picking Faszholz just because I've seen her in the UFC, and I feel like I have a better... I feel like she's a little better oriented for that level of fighting. Mm-hmm. Odds on that fight, Vieira is... plus 103 down to minus 111. Faszholz minus 111 down to minus 125. So basically dead even. That's fine.
Yep.
Nothing to pick there, really. That brings us to a heavyweight bout. Cody East versus Curtis Blaydes. Well, I know who I want to win.
Yep.
I want Curtis Blaydes to win. I feel like he should win this. He's a big, powerful wrestler. His stand-up is very wooden and sloppy, but he's also got the kind of power there to make that not as important. The big concern against a fighter like East, though, is that East is very light on his feet and very fast for his size in general. Hand speed, foot speed. He's a fast fighter. At heavyweight, he's got power. So if Blaydes can't track him down easily, then he's going to end up getting picked apart the way, you know, just in a bad way. Even, I don't know, it sort of, kind, you know, I don't want to say like Francis Ngannou because that's a very different fight, but it's just, it's going to be a struggle for Blaydes if he's not fast enough to wrestle at this level. Yeah. And I don't know. I'm a bit split here. I feel like I'm going to pick Blaydes because he is such a powerful wrestler. And I think East in a similar kind, like East was winning a very similar matchup with Walt Harris before getting knocked out in that fight. And where Harris is a much cleaner puncher, but Harris is also not a wrestler at all, like not capable of changing the fight. He had to punch with East. And so I feel like Blaydes can drive through, get takedowns, and do a better job of changing the dynamic of the fight and being the bigger, more powerful fighter in there. But I'm not at all confident in that.
Yeah, I mean, right from the get-go, I'm compelled to pick Blaydes based on both of the two guys' last fights. It's maybe a little unfair. It's a little recency bias going on there, but Curtis Blaydes was doing his damnedest to convince the doctor to let him continue after having his eyes closed by Francis Ngannou. I don't know if you recall, but he had a neat little trick where he kept reaching up to grab the doctor's hand so that he could feel how many fingers he was holding up. And the doctor almost bought it. He came way too close to buying it for my comfort. We need some better doctors in there. Don't fall for that kind of shit. But that shows he's got some physical and mental toughness. You know, he went in there with a really hard heavyweight puncher with good pop in his hands and survived and didn't get a lot done, but it was really kind of Ngannou's like coming out performance of the fighter that he could be and has proven to be since. And Blaydes ended up being more overmatched than we expected. Cody East, however, was knocked out in his last fight, and at heavyweight, durability is probably the most important thing. Now, it's not like East is always getting knocked out. I think he's pretty tough, and I actually think Harris is a pretty explosive puncher. His skill set hasn't really backed up, and he's kind of a glass cannon, so he's struggled himself, but I think he definitely hits hard, and it was a shot that East literally ran headfirst into. So I don't know how much I can draw from that. But the big thing here is I don't think – you know, East's big advantage is that he's got really fast hands. He's pretty quick on his feet, and he's got really snappy punches, not something a lot of heavyweights have. You get a lot of thudding power, just weight behind the shots, but he has good, you know, he cracks when he hits you with his hands. But I don't think you need to mash that speed to beat him if you can get him past the first round. He's consistently struggled with stamina past the first round. I think he's a very kind of relies on his dynamism. Relies on that athletic quickness. It's not really a technical quickness. He's not loose. He's pushing everything to go really fast. And at heavyweight in particular, I like wrestlers when things start to slow down and everyone's tired better than I like strikers, because it's easier to hold people down. There's more weight involved. One takedown can seal an entire round in this division. And Blaydes is a very good level change, fairly long distance wrestler. He's also been training at Team Elevation, I think, since his loss to Ngannou, which is great because I think they've done great things with guys like Dan Hooker and TJ Dillashaw, looked as sharp as ever. We've seen some good things from that camp. So I'm going with Curtis Blaydes. In the end, I think I'm motivated to pick Curtis Blaydes because, as you said, Cody East, you didn't say this, but I'll say it, is kind of a shit heel, has a very troubled past, shall we say, and I don't really feel inclined to root for him. So take the pick with a grain of salt, but I'm saying Curtis Blaydes by third round TKO.
The other thing I will say that's in Blaydes' favor is the East is, other than being a good quick kicker, which he is, he's not otherwise a good distance striker.
Yeah.
He tends to need to close to the pocket and then unload a quick flurry of strikes and get back out. And that could mean that he closes right into a takedown from Blaydes. Yeah. If Blaydes can time him.
Yep.
So, I don't know. It is a grain of salt pick, though. For those out there, it's not something that I'm like, oh, man, I just know Blaydes is going to win this. It's more like I'm waiting for Blaydes to lose this really badly so that I can feel a little bad.
It's a bit of a frustrating matchup because Blaydes just had his first loss against a prospect who proved to be way too much for him. They're like, all right, here's another pretty much top prospect who also had a loss. I don't know. I know the UFC loves their, like, you have to earn your place in the promotion type of fights, but, you know, Blaydes is the kind of fighter I want to develop. He's young. He has a shot-based wrestling game. That's the kind of stuff that I want to see at heavyweight.
Yeah.
And I hope they don't burn him out.
Yeah. That said, Blaydes is a comfortable favorite, probably too comfortable for those of you interested in betting. Although, don't bet on heavyweight fights. Good God, just don't. But still, Blaydes is at -210 to -250. East at +206 to +165. And this feels much more like a closer to pick 'em fight.
Yeah. And I mean, I think East is worth a bet there, honestly. I know it's heavyweight, but just on the fact that East has knockout power, I think maybe the other bet to make that really tempts me is over 1.5 rounds, which is listed at +105 down to -105. I think any of those are good odds because Blaydes is not like a first-round knockout artist kind of puncher, and he's very durable, so he can probably withstand most of East's early output.
Yeah, Blaydes reminds me a lot of Brock Lesnar. Not in the, like, I don't want to be like, oh, in the future champ hype train, but in that Brock Lesnar was never much of a one-punch KO artist. It was the fact that he was so big and so powerful that he just, every shot he hit would chip you away.
Yes.
And after one or two rounds of getting hit like that, guys would just be like, okay, I'm done.
Blaydes can get to a point where he can hold you against the fence or get you on the ground, and he will just basically turn you into a paste without ever really knocking you out.
Yeah, he's a huge, huge dude with just absolutely outsized on the same kind of scale as Ngannou. That brings us to a light heavyweight bout, Jonathan Wilson versus Ion Cutelaba.
One of the light heavyweight fights that I am excited for. I think both of these guys are really good fun to watch. I actually rewatching Jonathan Wilson's fight with Frank Waston Jr., Luis Enrique da Silva, a.k.a. Frankenstein, a.k.a. Frank Waston Jr. That was a hell of a fun fight. It was really, really entertaining. Back and forth. Wilson doesn't really have a defensive acumen, but he's very fast and hits really hard. He's kind of like the light heavyweight Walt Harris in some ways, that he has that kind of – he seems to have an innate ability to land these heavy southpaw shots and maybe isn't that good at absorbing punishment or going past the first round. But that's one round of very exciting action. And then Cutelaba looked pretty bad in his fight with Misha Sirkunov, but I think it was just too much for him in a bad style matchup. Sirkunov threatened him with the takedowns and then actually spent the fight kind of outboxing him. Because I think Cutelaba was partially worried about those takedowns. But in other matchups we've seen from him, he's a good aggressive boxer. Not great defensively either, but packs power and speed. And the big thing in his favor here is that he seemed completely fine to keep coming forward and keep throwing, even after being beaten up for 10 minutes by Misha Sirkunov. And Jonathan Wilson was done by the end of the first round in his last fight. Granted, that was a very fast pace, and he may have learned from that, but I think stamina is pretty valuable among the heavier divisions. The ability to take punishment and keep coming forward and keep throwing at a high clip. And so for that reason, I think Cutelaba will get the win in second or third round, TKO probably.
Yeah, this really does feel like a good style matchup for Cutelaba to me with his boxing. I'm not saying that Misha Sirkunov is a better offensive boxer than Jonathan Wilson, but he's, I think, a better put together fighter than Jonathan Wilson. Like everything he's doing is more integrated into an overall game that makes it harder to solve. Mm-hmm. And yeah, he is also like a massive, I think probably one of those cases too of being just like a massive size thing where sometimes fighters, they see a guy across from them like, I'm not going after that dude. You kidding me?
Yeah.
And I don't know that Wilson has that same imposing feel to him. He's definitely fast. He's definitely a good athlete. He also came to the UFC basically with no pro fights, having fought only in Explode. Yeah. So he's having to learn what it's like to actually fight real athletes and real opposition.
The fight with Frankenstein was pretty encouraging considering that it was like the first fight where he was really pressed and he almost finished Frankenstein after gassing. So
yeah, he's got the guts. It's just, he doesn't have the experience of what it's like to be in there with guys who can go after him, who can push him.
Yeah.
And I think Cutelaba has much more of that and is much more ready to face that challenge right now. So even if Wilson could be a better fighter 5 years from now than Cutelaba will be 5 years from now, I have to pick Cutelaba right now because I also don't see Wilson, you know, hitting big takedowns or being able to change things up enough to keep this from being anything more than a straight kickboxing match.
Well, he's a millennia MMA guy. That kind of makes sense.
Yep. Yeah, and which all the millennia MMA dudes, they all go through Explode too. Like that's where they build a record there. They usually get one legit win in like RFA or Legacy or Tachi or something like that. And then that one win is enough to convince the UFC to bring them on board. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of them go right home.
Yeah.
They get like two fights in the UFC, lose both of them, and then end up back on the regional circuit. So it is not the most successful process in the world.
No.
The odds on that fight, Cutelaba is the favorite, -152 to -165. Jonathan Wilson, the underdog, +143 to +125. That seemed perfectly right to me. that brings us to the Fight Pass prelim headliner, between a middleweight bout between Nate Marquardt and Tamdan McCrory. And this is kind of a must-win fight for Tamdan, honestly. Much more so than it is a must-win fight for Marquardt. You know, even if Marquardt is coming off a bad loss to Thiago Santos, Marquardt's in a position right at this point where, you know, I'm not expecting Nate Marquardt to win a lot of fights. When he does, it's like, oh wow, that's a pretty big surprise.
But Ben Henderson, like, he's in a very similar position. The pressure's kind of off, and it's like a big slap on the back for him if he wins, because holy shit, like, he can still do it.
Exactly. That said, this is a good, very good style matchup for Nate. Tamdan McCrory is not a good range striker at all. And as much as he is an aggressive clinch grappler, an aggressive ground grappler, he's not an amazing wrestler either. So he is actually going to have to work to solve Marquardt. Like, this is going to require a process out of McCrory. I still think probably he can press Marquardt, who tends to hang back and wait on opponents, who doesn't pull the trigger that often, even if he did knock out CB Dollaway. I think McCrory can press him and get him into the clinch and do enough damage in the clinch to force scrambles and to hurt Marquardt and to force a fight that he wants and will be better for him. But I'm interested to see it. Like, McCrory should be able to win this off aggression and power and finishing instincts. But he's going to have to go through a bad style matchup, a lot like the Christoph Yatko matchup, to do it. And the big thing on his side is that Marquardt has more trouble pulling the trigger than Yatko does these days.
But a lot more power. That's the thing, you know. It would be a mistake to draw too much from it. It happens. Everybody gets knocked out. Everybody gets knockouts at one point or another. On a good day, John Fitch could drop you with a right hand, or Jake Shields could knock your head off with a left hook. It just has to land on the right spot at the right time. But it's still not a good look to be knocked out brutally by a guy with only four other TKOs to his name.
Yeah, and Yatko's boxing is improving rapidly, which I think is a big part of that. But still, Marquardt has a long history of being...
He hasn't... Yeah, even so, Yatko hasn't TKO'd anybody since 2011, and two of his other four TKOs are doctor stoppages. So he's not a guy known for his one-shot power, and he just obliterated Tamdan McCrory. He turned his legs to water. And it looked so like the kind of shots that Nate Marquardt has been finishing guys with lately. That's what worries me about it. I'm glad you were the first one to say that this is kind of a good fight for Marquardt, because I agree. And in the end, I think I'm going to pick McCrory for the same reason that I've been picking everybody against guys like Marquardt and Henderson lately, because of the age and the wear and tear. Marquardt, he was a guy who he never used to be really that fragile. I think the first time he was ever knocked out was by Anderson Silva, and that was in like 30 fights or something. And now in his last 10 fights or so, he's been knocked out three times. He's knocked out five times in his last 10 or so fights. And so it does seem like his durability is going away. It hasn't always even been huge shots that have put him out. Although in fairness, he has faced some big punchers, guys like Ellenberger, Lombard, and even Thiago Santos is pretty powerful. So I'm going to pick McCrory because I think he can probably take more punishment than Marquardt. He can probably walk through some stuff to get into that range. But Marquardt is still fast with his hands. He still hits really hard. He's got really good timing, and so I would not be surprised if Marquardt knocked Tamdan McCrory out. I really wouldn't, you know.
Like I said, it kind of sucks because it's Tamdan McCrory. Like, I think this is honestly a must-win fight for him coming off that bad KO loss.
Yeah, like, it's got to suck to come in off of two fights as, like, this Bellator discovery. He decided to go to Bellator first, and then he gets two wins, and he comes back, and then, like, very shortly into his UFC career, to what I imagine will be stoppage losses in a row, is not a good look.
Yeah, like if he gets back-to-back KOs, the idea – because after that Saman win, it was very much like, is McCrory's running to the top 15. I expect him to be a top 15 fighter, even if he's – I'm not saying title challenger. I'm still saying a dude – you know, I expect to see him in there with Rafael Natal and Tim Boach and dudes like that. I expect McCrory to be in those fights and do well. If he gets knocked out by Christoph Yatko and Nate Marquardt, that dream is in serious peril.
Yatko is the man, though.
I love Yatko.
Let's take no shine away from the Polish prince, Christoph Yatko, who was on his own run to the top 10.
Yeah, Yatko is a complete dark horse top 10 fighter, a dude that nobody really saw coming that could very easily be in top contention in the next couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Yatko versus the loser of Brunson Whitaker. I'd like to see that.
Yeah, so this is a tough one. This is a bad style matchup for McCrory, and it's all coming down to picking him based on not being as shop-worn as Nate Marquardt.
Yep, and actually probably being a lot less shop-worn than most fighters his age, because he took all those years off just to kind of hang out with his kid and work on his jiu-jitsu.
Yep. On that note, Tamdan McCrory is the big favorite, -210 to -235. 240 actually, and Marquardt, the underdog, +196 to +175, and those odds seem wide to me.
Yeah. Man, I don't want to advise anyone to bet on Nate Marquardt
these days. I don't either. No, not at all.
If you can get Marquardt inside the distance, because that's the only way I think he really wins, you can get it at +250.
250, yeah. That's worth like a nickel. Like, maybe a nickel.
I'm going to put a dollar on Marquardt to win. That's going to be my bet. $1.
Yeah, because there's a chance. Like, this is in a style-versus-style matchup, this is a fight that favors Nate Marquardt.
You can absolutely see McCrory trying to get into that middle range and running into a big right hand.
Yep. That brings us to the Fox Sports 2 card. They're still doing such shit on Fox Sports 2. Why? Like, I guess if there's any card to do that, this run is a Fox Sports 2 run that we're about to go through.
Yeah, I suppose so.
But still. And the opening bout is a welterweight bout, Keita Nakamura versus Elizeu Zaleski.
I really like this matchup, actually. This is like one of those sneakily exciting style clashes. Elizeu Zaleski dos Santos has had trouble stopping takedowns and working with opponents who can out-grapple him. And yet he has always been very dogged in returning to his assault once he gets back to his feet, and has given two solid fighters in Omari Akhmedov and Nicholas Dalby very tough fights, beating Akhmedov and coming fairly close to beating Dalby. I think that was a split. So, and then Keita Nakamura is like, how can you not love that kind of veteran success story? The guy comes into the UFC after, let's see how many years of experience this guy have.
He started back in 2003. So 13 years of experience, and he was
32 years old.
7 years removed from his previous UFC run.
In which he did not do well at all.
No.
So, like, the expectations were, yeah, they're bringing him in for a Japan card. He'll be gone soon. And then he's using his special submission, his favorite submission, to finish two solid fighters in Jingyang Li and Kyle Noak. Both fights I didn't expect him to win. I think I picked against him in both of those. He looked really good in the Kyle Noak fight. He did exactly the right thing. He like pressured the hell out of Kyle Noak and made him uncomfortable. And even though his defense wasn't fantastic, Nakamura is extremely underrated in terms of toughness. He's had 42 fights and he's never been stopped. He's never been knocked out. He was
knocked out once by Jong Young Kim at 59 seconds of round one, which suggests a flash KO.
A flash kind of thing, right. So, okay, knocked out once. That's actually what I have written down here. So that says a lot about his durability and his ability to press the action against a dangerous fighter. But Elizeu Zaleski dos Santos, I think, is more dangerous than most. The thing is, man, Nakamura is a good takedown artist. He's a good scrambler. He's tough. He can probably take some shots. And Zaleski just keeps getting taken down by people early on in fights. And Nakamura is a savant with that. I said he's up there with Michael Chiesa as far as the rear naked choke kings go. The guy who just manages to slip that choke in on almost everybody he fights. I think he's gotten it 17 times over the course of his career. He's maybe had, oh, he has 17 submissions and 15 of them are rear naked chokes. It is his specialty. And I think he's going to do it to Dos Santos. So Zaleski Dos Santos, I suppose. I'm going with Nakamura by first round submission. I think if Zaleski can get out of the first round, then he can start to pile up damage, and his takedown defense tends to improve as the fight goes on. But I think if he gets taken down once or twice in the first frame, he's going to be in serious trouble, more so than with either of the other two guys he's fought, because he got put in some submissions by Akhmedov. You know, he didn't have a fun time on the ground, and Nakamura is better than Nakhmedov when it comes to cinching in the choke or the arm lock. So,
yeah, it's a weird fight. I mean, it's definitely the big question is Elizeu Zaleski consistent enough to beat Nakamura? And that's tough because, I mean, like, too, watching that Noak fight, like, Nakamura is he's not a good wrestler, first of all. Like, he's just not. Even, you know, his best successes have come, he dropped Noak, of all things.
Sure, yeah.
And against Li Jinglong, he just backpacked him standing.
He actually dropped Jinglong in the first round, which is how he had that really solid first round.
Yeah, he had a solid first round, and then you just backpacked him standing, if I'm remembering correctly.
He actually got sprawled on and then sat out and took his back.
Okay, so he's not a good wrestler, but he is a shockingly effective kickboxer for how bad his kickboxing is.
Yeah, who else is he like? He's like, who's a guy that Hanayaya beat not long ago and shouldn't have?
Michinori Tanaka, just the other day?
No. It was a guy he beat a while ago in a split decision. He hurt Alex Caceres with a right hand. Masanori Kanahara,
yeah.
He's stiff and upright. You're like, this guy's not a good striker. And then he just stuns almost everyone that he fights with these big right hooks. That's how Nakamura is, too.
Yeah, and so, and the thing is about it is that I think the biggest things are that he doesn't get tired and he doesn't stop fighting the way he wants to fight. Like, you're never going to change him or stop him from taking the approach he wants to take, which is, you know, he snaps out these big kicks, he'll leap in with these hands, the rhythm isn't consistent, which makes it tricky, and you can't hurt him. Like, you can't make him go away, so you have to be soundly beating him. And you have to be able to just out wrestle and out grapple him, like Tom Breeze did. And
Tom Breeze,
yeah,
ended up in some tough spots.
He ended up in fighting off a lot of tough spots. Guys just seem to find it really tough to out kickbox Keita Nakamura, and Zaleski Dos Santos hits hard enough to knock him out. He hits hard enough to knock a lot of people out. But if he can't find the consistency to do that, like if he can't put together the punches to actually make that happen, it just seems like Nakamura's going to be right there pressuring him, finding some way to force a scramble, to force a clinch, to force an exchange where Zaleski goes down or gets his back taken and loses. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I got to pick Nakamura too. I'd love to see Zaleski, you know, find a way to show up and get that win.
So Zaleski's one of your like soft spot guys, isn't he?
I mean, I like him a little. I like that his whole like capoeira power thing and
yeah.
I don't know. He's a fun dude who has the ability to turn a corner, but you know, seeing Nakamura beat guys like Kyle Noak and Li Jinglong, who are much more, well, no, questionably more consistent, but Li Jinglong more consistent. And Kyle Noak more technical, it doesn't give me a lot of faith in Zaleski here. Odds on this fight, Nakamura is the favorite, minus 135 to minus 161. And Zaleski, the underdog, plus 130 to plus 110. And that seems pretty fair to me. Zaleski's got power. Nakamura is by no means a dominating force in the cage, so I don't think it should be a massive split between them, but Nakamura should probably be favored.
Yeah, no problem with it.
That brings us to another heavyweight bout that I'm weirdly interested in and excited for. Shamil Abdurakhimov versus Walt Harris.
Yeah, Walt Harris, man. He was right on the chopping block for his next sacrifice. Guy was in the UFC. I think he lost twice, got booted, got brought back in. And then he had to fight Cody East, and that was a fight that Cody East had a lot more momentum than Walt was expected to win, was mostly winning a fairly back-and-forth first round, and then got flatlined. And I don't know how much that says about Walt Harris. I think we all knew from just having seen him when he first made his UFC debut that he was a dangerous guy. Fast, explosive, looks very athletic, but we don't really know how he looks outside the first round. And we now know that he doesn't really take a punch maybe as well as you would want a heavyweight prospect to do. Fortunately for him, Shamil Abdurakhimov is not a super powerful puncher. Most accomplished heavyweights finish Anthony Hamilton when they beat him, and Abdurakhimov could not. But as he showed in that fight, and unfortunately for Walt Harris, Abdurakhimov is a very good striker. By heavyweight standards, he has really nice timing. He moves laterally and takes angles when he counters, and he can put together some strikes at pretty much every distance. And so I don't think he needs to really strike that hard to hurt a guy like Walt Harris if Harris is kind of lunging into something, or if he's just placing his shots really well. And I don't really see Harris with speed alone catching a guy like Abdurakhimov off guard. You know, I think you kind of need to out-wrestle him, or you're going to need to be able to compete with him technically. And there's a pretty big gap between these two guys as far as skill goes. So should be fun. Should be a lot of punches getting thrown. I like a relatively technical, fast-paced heavyweight striking match. The big consequences of heavyweight punches make that a fun thing to watch. But I think the smart pick has to be Abdurakhimov by, I'm thinking maybe a later knockout, but I wouldn't be shocked if he sparked Walt Harris in the first round either, if he just landed one perfect uppercut.
Yeah, it's I think one of the big things here is that Harris doesn't make very good use of his speed. Mm-hmm. Like, he's not a fast, you talk about him being fast, having fast hands, being powerful. He makes good use of his power, but he's not a fighter that I think of and I'm like, oh yeah, Walt Harris, he's so fast. Like, I think he's pretty
quick for a heavyweight, but he just doesn't have the technical acumen to really make that count. Like, when he strikes, yeah, I think he covers hit, that hand will shoot out there pretty quickly. He's got a really good body kick, a good left kick, but a lot of unnecessary movement, and he's clearly uncomfortable when he's exchanging. He looks like a much less experienced Lorenz Larkin in the pocket. You remember when Larkin was exchanging punches with Albert Tumanov and he was so clearly the less comfortable of the two in terms of boxing? Walt Harris looks like that even when someone's not in range. He's not comfortable with that distance at all.
Yeah, because, like, you're talking about that Cody East fight. Cody East, to me, you know, even if we're not talking, even if, as you say, he's pushing things, he's really working hard to be more dynamic, he's not fluid. Cody East, to me, I think of him as a fast heavyweight. He's somebody that closes distance, gets in, and then gets back out to a safe range, who works to make that speed count for him. Harris just kind of, you know, he comes in, he'll try and, outspeed you with a punch or two, but he doesn't get back out. Like, there's no, let me then make that speed work, any foot speed work for me to be elusive or hard to track down. It's just sort of, let me walk into you and pray that my hands are faster.
And it's a lot of single shots, too. Like, he throws combinations, which makes really good use of his speed. You'll get hit with four shots before you, the big, slow heavyweight, know what's happening. Harris, it's like, if you can defend that first strike, you're probably okay. And if you throw back, he's going to scuttle out of range because he doesn't like it.
Yeah. So, I got to pick up Abdurakhimov here too. Also, I think Abdurakhimov is more capable of changing the tone of the fight if he needs to. He's not a great defensive wrestler, but he's a pretty okay offensive wrestler, a functional one. And I think if Harris, if he doesn't feel like he's got the bead on Harris striking, that he can take him down or shoot to make Harris think about takedowns, whereas Harris, you know, he's pretty much just going to be boxing. Mm-hmm. And, Abdurakhimov feels like the better pick all around, especially with dirty boxing, too. Like, he's a very good dirty boxer and clinch boxer. So if he can track Harris down and make this an ugly fight, even if he's getting out-muscled by Harris, I feel like he can land better shots inside.
Yeah, everyone complained about it when it was happening, but I thought that Abdurakhimov versus Hamilton was good to watch. It was about as close to a technical masterclass of striking as you get to see in this division. So, you know, I think that Abdurakhimov's skill is pretty clear.
Yeah. The odds on this are basically even. Walt Harris, the underdog, plus 103 down to minus 110. And Shamil Abdurakhimov, minus 113 to minus 125. I think Abdurakhimov could be a bigger favorite than that, probably should be, but do not bet on this fight and do not bet on heavyweight fights. There is a very good chance that Harris just catches him with one big shot and knocks him out, just like Harris is getting beat by Cody East.
I'm kind of tempted, though. I'm kind of tempted to bet on it.
God, don't do it.
Come on, man. Abdurakhimov is better than that. He's minus 115 on my book. He's better than that, man. He's not Cody East. The guy has a lot of experience.
I know, but
I'm not going to advise anybody else to, but I'm going to go ahead right now and put $2 on Shamil Abdurakhimov.
All right. There you have it. Bad decisions all around. That brings us to Hacran Diaz versus Andre Fili.
I'm weirdly into this fight. Oh, is this yours?
I think it is. Yeah. I think it is.
Go on.
I like this fight. I do not think Andre Fili wins this fight. Hmm. Andre Fili he's one of those dudes who, to me, has been getting a lot of praise for a long time with very little result to actually show for it.
It's because he's fun.
Yeah, it's because he's fun and he's a cool dude. Like, everybody, you hear him talk, you see his Twitter feed and all that, and you're like, this dude's cool, I like him.
The guy tweets about pizza and he puts on crazy brawls. What's not to like, right?
Yeah. He feels to me exactly like the kind of reason that Hacran Diaz is the gatekeeper he's become, though. Hmm. Which is that Hacran Diaz is not a dangerous fighter, really, at all. He fights at this very, you know, it's like Jose Aldo is Hacran Diaz with the brakes off. And Hacran Diaz is Jose Aldo with all the brakes on. So
technically, Jose Aldo and Hacran Diaz are the most similar looking fighters at Novo Niao. It's just that Jose Aldo has a mean streak.
Yeah. And so Hacran Diaz, he's very, very comfortable to just stand out at range, pick his shots. If he sees an opening, he'll land a shot. He'll land a leg kick. He'll land a good straight punch. But he won't actually create any offense. He'll never create openings to work with. He will take whatever you give him, and that's that. And he backs that up by being a solid enough wrestler to grind out rounds if he needs to, and a good enough grappler that you're probably not going to out-grapple him on the ground, at least not easily. Andre Fili's just a dude who gives people openings. He gives people a lot to work with. He can beat fighters that aren't as good as him. And that Gabriel Benitez head kick KO, like, that was a good showing of how dynamic Fili can be and the kind of offense he can create. And against other fighters like Felipe Arantes, who give a lot of openings and who give you a lot to work with, Fili will be right there scrambling with you, working with you, making a fight close and ugly. But it all comes at a price for Fili. Everything Fili does comes at a price to him. And Hacran Diaz is exactly like, he's a safety first fighter who's just going to, you know, you have to be good enough to create things without giving a lot back to Hacran Diaz, because he's not going to give you a lot of opportunities to create and to work with. And if you give him openings, he'll do just enough to squeak out rounds. So I'm picking Hacran Diaz by the kind of uninspired decision that keeps him as a borderline top 15 fighter and keeps Andre Fili as a permanently not top 15 fighter.
You're not the first person I've spoken to who looks at this matchup that way. And the reason why it's weirdly interesting to me, even though it may very well not be a good fight, depending on which way it goes, is that it's two completely opposite approaches to fighting. It is a guy who is too cautious versus a guy who doesn't know what that word means. A guy who is incredibly aggressive and a guy who struggles to pull the trigger. And so you're looking at this way. Pat, I think, agrees with you. That kind of frames the fight as Hacran Diaz doesn't give openings, and Andre Fili does. I kind of see this fight as Hacran Diaz doesn't attack openings, and Andre Fili does. It's hard to show Andre Fili anything that half resembles an opening without him going for it. That has gotten him in trouble. Wrestle with guys he shouldn't wrestle with. He will let his hands go and leave himself open to counters. But it means that he's scoring. And defense does not win rounds. Offense wins rounds. You have to be scoring the strikes or scoring the positions or threatening submissions or whatever. And I don't think Hacran Diaz under duress will pull the trigger enough to score more points than Andre Fili. The thing I see him being able to do that makes this fight seem close to me is his wrestling ability. And his physical strength. Both these guys are great athletes, but Hacran Diaz is very much like a brick shit house. He's really strong. He's pretty explosive, but really he can hold you down and just kind of yank you to the ground, even without a beautiful takedown. So that's what I see him doing. But I have seen a lot of fights of his where he'll go long periods of time without even going for that shot. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking primarily of the Cub Swanson fight. And Swanson's a lot more accomplished than Andre Fili, but I think he's also fading. That was not a great performance from him. And Andre Fili, I think, is better from that kicking range where Diaz likes to hang out. So I'm not convinced that Diaz is going to go for those takedowns in the early rounds often enough to control Fili, who is a pretty good scrambler and kind of aggressive enough to create space. And I'm not convinced that he's dangerous enough to punish Fili for his over-aggressiveness. So I can totally see either way on this one, but to keep things interesting, I'm going to go with Fili by unanimous decision.
Yeah, I think the other part of it for me is that I think that Fili will give more opportunities to be out-wrestled than Cub Swanson does. Sure. Cub Swanson's a much more patient fighter in his vein, as weird as that is to say about Cub Swanson.
He fights in he's wild and crazy like Fili when he does attack, but he fights in spots.
Yeah, he very much picks the spots where he thinks he can do something crazy. Mm-hmm. Fili does not. Fili just lets crazy happen, and so I think that Fili will give him more to work with in that way, in a way that allows Hacran Diaz to just shut him down, kind of, you know. Mm-hmm.
Could be.
Yeah. All right. On that note, the odds for that fight, Hacran Diaz is the favorite, -172 to -200. Andre Fili, the favorite, +165 to underdog, rather. Andre Fili, the underdog, +165 to +150. I think that feels about right to me.
It's okay. Yeah. Even though I've already bet on some more narrow lines, I don't think I would go for Fili at +165. I just think this is a too unpredictable of a matchup, two very different guys who both look very different depending on who they're fighting. So
it's also a narrow favorite for a guy who tends to win these kind of fights at this level. Yeah. Like Hacran Diaz tends to beat this level of opponent and keep himself.
Yeah.
You know, he beats Yuri Alcantara. Andre Fili, on the flip side, loses to Yair Rodriguez. And
he's, Hacran Diaz is the guy who would beat Ricardo Lamas if only he weren't Hacran Diaz.
Like, exactly.
If only he weren't so cautious.
Yeah, and Andre Fili, like, Hacran Diaz, I can see Hacran Diaz beating Godofredo Pepe. I cannot see Yair Rodriguez. And we saw Andre Fili versus Godofredo Pepe, and he got Flying Triangle. Like, that's kind of...
Though I could see him beating Pepe.
I could see him beating Pepe.
But I could almost see anyone beating or losing to Pepe. So
it's just, I haven't seen Fili have any success at this level. Like, sure. Yeah, like,
that is fair.
A high enough level of success.
Yep.
And that brings us to the prelim headliner, Luis Henrique da Silva, Frank Waston Jr. versus Joachim Christensen.
Have we ever explained that nickname on the Vivisection?
I don't know. I feel like we have, but why don't you go ahead and explain it?
Well, given his appearance and his, like, slow, relentless onslaught style of fighting, he picked up the nickname Frankenstein. And for some strange reason, the Portuguese rendering of that nickname was Frank Waston Jr.
I think it's mostly that the Portuguese pronunciation of Frankenstein was
dense. It was like Frank Westein.
Then that when people in the U.S. heard it and needed to write it down for
fight records, that's it. Yeah,
they wrote Frank Waston.
Yeah, Frank Westein Jr. or something like that. And so it got mistranslated. So Frank Waston Jr. lives on. He's super fun to watch fight. He is one of my favorite types of fighters, the crazy Brazilian brawler with sneakily good jiu-jitsu. Like, that is kind of his thing. And he fights a guy who is a solid, well-rounded light heavyweight, but an older one who has kind of yet to step up against a higher level of competition. Joachim Christensen is... Yeah, his level's been okay as far as regional light heavyweight.
Like, he beat Max Nunez and... Yeah. Who was the other guy? He beat Stefan Puetz and Jonas Billenstein. Like, he's beat as good a light heavyweight outside the UFC as he could hope to.
He's 37 years old, though, so it's tough to really expect that to keep going on for much longer. Luis Henrique da Silva is way younger than his Frankenstein's monster face looks. I think he's 24, 27. But very young by light heavyweight standards, 10 full years younger than Christensen. And I kind of like him to win here by being a crazy man. I could see Christensen picking him apart a little bit, but kind of like Jonathan Wilson before him, Christensen's striking looks good to a point until he's kind of put into pressure and he kind of turns into a brawler. It looks really pretty. He's like a focus mitt star. He's going to look amazing on the pads. But when he's sparring, it's maybe not all, the comfort level is maybe not all there. And so things start to get a little sloppy. Luis Henrique da Silva is not a pretty striker, but he's like the same level of moderately ugly, no matter what's going on. He is a prodigious body puncher. He is very good in the clinch with his knees and with his uppercuts. He can take a hell of a shot. And he's one of those guys who just keeps coming even when he's exhausted. I'm not sure who's scarier, the guys who don't get exhausted or the guys who get exhausted and don't change tactics. But he is the latter. So I like him by second round TKO. Frank Waston Jr. rides again.
Yeah, I think the big thing for me here is that Christensen, both guys depend a lot on their chin. Christensen... Yeah. You know, he's a very stalking, flat-footed striker who likes to step in, and then he will get – his hooks are sloppy. That's the big thing. He throws a really nice straight 1-2.
Yeah.
But when he starts to mix in longer combinations and tries to throw hooks, that's when things just start looping way out.
Whenever he's exchanging or countering or trying to throw shorter punches, it's like really wide, head dead center – chin up in the air, everything gets... I mean, he got tagged up by... you keep talking, I'll find his name.
Okay, but despite all that, he has a great chin. Like, he's never been KO'd, I don't think. And he's, you know, he's really tough and hard to put away. He hits and he hits hard enough at that size that the fact that he's just willing to stand in and trade makes him more dangerous than the fact than his technique would otherwise.
Sure, yeah. Anthony Ruiz is the guy who is an awful striker, and he was tagging Christensen at will.
Yeah. The big thing that has me picking Frankenstein here, Frank Waston, is that I think he actually, for the despite the fact that he's no more technical than Christensen, and certainly not more technical as an inside striker, like in the mid range, Christensen is a better, cleaner, has a smoother 1-2 delivery by far. But Frank Waston is better in the clinch and better outside. So you have two stalking fighters, neither of whom are especially fast-moving or dynamic. And one guy has to keep the fight in a mid-range, and the other one can work from way outside as a better kicker or way inside as a better clinch striker. And that should push to Henrique da Silva's favor. The big difference will be if Christensen can get takedowns, he's got a sneaky trip and drag game from body lock.
Yeah.
He's not a good wrestler, but his body lock game is good. Then Christensen is a very effective, solid ground and pound finisher.
Yeah. Da Silva did have some nice moments against Jonathan Wilson, though Wilson's top game really looked lackluster. But despite surprising him with some takedowns, he swept him really nicely, I think, both times he was taken down.
And Christensen, because he's so aggressive on the ground, does not create great control there. Yeah. He often lets guys up that while trying to find shots to land. So, the X factor is Christensen getting takedowns from body lock and then turning that into a big advantage. But if he doesn't, then he's going to have a limited window against a very tough opponent where he has to land the harder shots in mid-range or face getting kicked at distance or kneed in the clinch. Mm-hmm. So I got to pick Frank Waston there. Luis Henrique da Silva is the favorite, minus 122 to minus 160. Christensen, the underdog, plus 125 to plus 105. I am totally fine with that. These two dudes are both durable. They both hit decently hard. The big advantages on Da Silva's side are youth and variety, really.
Yeah. So
that brings us to our main card, Luis Smolka versus Brandon Moreno. And I'm going to keep this pretty simple in that Smolka should absolutely style on Brandon Moreno. Like, I don't want to – this is going to come off as cold, and I hate being this kind of cold. But Brandon Moreno got out-wrestled by a one-legged dude. Like, legitimately out-wrestled – by a guy with one leg. And, like, maybe that says that the guy with one leg is much better than you would expect.
Maybe there's a certain level of awkwardness to fighting someone with a drastically different build.
Yeah, there's a certain level of awkwardness. There's a certain level of weirdness to fighting somebody with a missing limb.
Yeah.
Where you're just like, do I really want to just beat this guy?
Can't kick him in the face either. It's tough.
No. But Moreno's also been taken down really easily in almost every other fight.
Yep.
So that makes me feel like it's not so much the one-legged guy being awesome and that fight being awkward as it is Moreno just being not a good wrestler at all.
Yep.
And this is a problem for him because he tends – the way he finishes fights is by out-grappling people. You know, he's scrappy. He's got good cardio. He will work from everywhere. He will be aggressive and stay with people. He's a flyweight, so he makes that happen. But Smolka has become, slowly but surely, a chain wrestling, submission grappling machine as a flyweight. Like, there are very few flyweights. You know, there's like the top five, and then there are very few other dudes who chain wrestle the way Luis Smolka does in that division.
In this division, there are two people who are maybe as good as like abusive, smothering top position fighters, and it's probably Wilson Hayes and Demetrius Johnson are the only two guys that are possibly better than Smolka. I think Johnson definitely is. In terms of aggressiveness and the willingness to strike on the ground, he may be better than Hayes in terms of like how effective he actually is when he has you on the floor.
Yeah. Smolka has really turned his lengthy frame into a major advantage when you get into grappling scrambles with him. Mm-hmm. And Moreno is a boxer, like he's probably about equal with Smolka, and he tends to stand very rigid with his head right on line and go for big, exciting moves that leave him wide open to being taken down. So this should be a walk for Smolka. I expect him to win pretty easily.
Yeah, I think Moreno has a lot of potential because he's young and he's very scrappy. He has natural scrambling ability, I think.
He reacts
really well to pressure, and he is willing to throw down. Like, he definitely does not lack guts, and he seems to have natural ability and doesn't seem very well trained at all. So I think the natural ability really shines. He'd be a good fit probably for a team like Jackson's or like Alliance if he were to move to a bigger camp. But for the time being, I agree with you. I think it's just a really rough matchup. Smolka's an underrated wrestler. He's fantastic from top position. And really from any position on the ground, he's going to find his way on top of you. And we saw in the Ben Nguyen fight, he can beat you up even if he can't submit you. So I think Smolka by submission is the pick.
That brings us the odds on that fight. Luis Smolka is the favorite, the largest favorite on the card, in fact. -400 to -470. Brandon Moreno +389 to +290. That feels absolutely right to me. He should be the largest favorite on this card.
I think it may be worth betting on Smolka or betting on the fight to go less than a round and a half at +140. That's what my book is showing. I think like Moreno's coming in on short notice. I assume hadn't been training for a fight because he's probably still kind of secretive because of the Ultimate Fighter going on. And it's just a bad matchup. Like if you come in underprepared for Smolka, he got Ben Nguyen out of there in almost a round and a half. And that fight.
Oh, we just lost Connor. So Connor's got the prop bet there for you. You want to finish that or?
He got Ben Nguyen out of there pretty quickly, and Ben Nguyen was very, very scrappy, and the fight was really back and forth. I don't expect Moreno to put up that effective of a fight.
Brandon Moreno feels a lot like Ben Nguyen as a worse athlete. Like, Ben Nguyen is a powerhouse. Moreno is like, if you took all the power out of Ben Nguyen's game, you'd get Brandon Moreno.
Yeah, kind of.
You know? That's my feeling.
And some of the grappling ability. Like, Nguyen looked pretty sharp on the ground in that fight until he started to wear out.
Yeah. All right, that brings us to a welterweight bout, Josh Burkman versus Zach Ottow.
Burkman, we got an inexperienced guy who's kind of a bruiser with a grappling bent, and you can say what you will for Josh Burkman. The guy's not easy to take down. He's dangerous if you do take him down. He's got a really good guillotine, and he is an inconsistent but very dangerous striker with just about any number of a wide selection of strikes. I think the fact that he has an embarrassment of riches in terms of strikes because he seems sometimes at a loss what tack to take. But that doesn't mean that he can't hurt you with just about anything he throws. And he's still incredibly tough. You know, he was knocked out recently. That bears watching. But he has taken some shots in his recent fights and given, like, the fight with Paul Felder, very close, you know. That's a guy who, by all rights, should be easily beating someone with Berkman's level of wear and tear, and he didn't.
No.
So, I'm going with Josh Burkman.
Knockout loss to Patrick Cote, that was a late, ugly, hard fight. Like, it wasn't like Burkman just got dropped, like, took a few shots and was out. That was a long...
Yeah, after kind of being the first guy to crack Cote fairly on the chin and hurt him too. Like the fight, he was winning the early portion of that fight. So I think Burkman by submission. I think Otto's going to get desperate and shoot and get caught in the guillotine.
Yeah, I can easily see that. I'm picking Burkman by decision. I think that Burkman, as time goes on, the biggest thing I see out of him more and more is that he, you know, kind of in that same Nate Marquardt vein, he just can't pull the trigger anymore. Like, he should still be able to handily win this fight, but it's really a lot of how Burkman fights right now is all about how he shows up. And, like, his most recent win, that KJ Nunes fight, there was literally, like, a round and a half where two strikes were thrown between the two of them.
It was a smart fight from him, I think. He's like, don't get into boxing range at all. Just kick him. I mean, I get it.
It would be a smart fight from him if it were not did not look so much like the other fights that he's lost.
Yeah, that's true.
It's like, okay, that was smart. Was it smart when he did the same thing with Dongyoung Kim? And, you know, was it smart when he did the same thing against Paul Felder when it really looked like every time Burkman actually decided to pressure Paul Felder, he was winning?
Yeah.
Like,
frustrating guy to watch.
He's a very, very frustrating. He's one of my least favorite types of fighters to watch, in fact. That said, Ottow, he's really an all-offense, no-defense fighter. It feels like it. He's this big powerhouse. He will come in aggressively looking to strike in a way that leaves openings, that leaves him open, to being taken down. And for a guy that's really like a grappler by nature and a wrestler by nature and this big powerhouse, he gives up positions on the ground. Like, you watch him in what fights out there are available of his, and guys that are smaller than him, that seem less athletic than him, that seem less polished than him, will sweep him, will turn in his guard, will, you know, find ways to get out of back mount and things like that and put him in a bad spot. And I think Burkman is still a fighter very capable of fighting hard and doing well when he's pressured. And the problems tend to be for him when he's not pressured well. He'll just coast. Mm-hmm. And I think that Ottow will try and pressure him with this very no-defense style and give Burkman openings to work his more dynamic game.
It's hard to imagine Ottow successfully out-wrestling Josh Burkman.
Yeah.
That's the real, like, that's his path to victory. And more often than not, it's Josh Burkman taking people down these days and not the other way around.
Yeah, I mean, Burkman's not bad at anything. It's weird because he's not bad at anything. He's just not amazing at anything either. So you get him up against this really elite level, and it's like, okay, you know, he can outstrike Dongyoung Kim, but he can't out-grapple or out-wrestle him at all. And he can, you know, he has no tools to answer somebody like Hector Lombard or something, things like that, like where at a certain level, he's just not presenting any answers to opponents. But below that level, he's a really dangerous wrestler, a dangerous grappler, and a dangerous striker that you can't just walk over and expect to dominate.
For sure.
So I think Ottow is very much the level of guy that Burkman should still beat. Odds on that fight, Josh Burkman is the favorite, minus 223 to minus 245, or 255 actually. Ottow, the underdog, plus 211 to plus 175. I would not recommend betting on Ottow, but I would say I can imagine this very easily if Ottow presses the fight, becoming an ugly, sloppy-ass split decision where Burkman nearly gives up rounds just for lack of trying.
Maybe.
That sticks out in my mind as a possibility. Now we're getting to a fight that I don't know how people. Okay, I don't know how people see this. I haven't spent a lot of time looking at what other predictions are on this fight, but I think this is going to be a hot mess. This is going to be a weird ass. Hot mess of a fight that I think a lot of people think is going to be a lot more clear-cut than it will be. And I'm talking about the co-main event, a lightweight fight between Will Brooks and Alex Oliveira. Now, Will Brooks is one of those dudes, like, Will Brooks to me a little bit, and I say this as somebody who I still think he's a very good fighter, a potentially elite lightweight, very strong athlete. He is potentially a bit of like Andre Fili 2.0 to me, where the actual in-cage, like, unlike Fili, he wins those fights, but the actual in-cage product is less than the expected, like, less than the hype when people talk about Will Brooks. They talk about him like, oh, he's an amazing athlete and an amazing wrestler and, you know, just this really powerful striker, and he's got all these tools going for him. And then you watch him, and he can't take Ross Pearson down to save his life. And he was able to be faster and more powerful and stay elusive and land the better shots on Pearson over the fight. But it was a really close fight against somebody that elite level, top of the division fighters tend to beat pretty handily. You know? Like, Ross Pearson's a tough dude in a tough fight, but the very top, you know, the top five at lightweight tend to beat Ross Pearson without a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And Will Brooks kind of skated through that fight. Like, it was a win, but it was no point was I, like, watching Will Brooks dominate Ross Pearson. And, I mean, he had a not dominating win over Dave Jansen, too. Like, Dave Jansen's a funky-ass dude and a tough fight, and Will Brooks won that fight. But this was not a fight where it's like, oh, Will Brooks is tearing apart Dave Jansen out there. It was like, Dave Jansen's kind of landing a lot of shots on this, and his lack of athleticism and lack of competitive power is steering this in Brooks' favor as the fight goes on and Jansen wears down. But it's not something that I immediately see as, like, this amazing Will Brooks performance. So when you get somebody like Alex Oliveira in there, who's a huge lightweight and who is a good kicker, like Brooks is a better, much better kicker than he is boxer by far. And neither of them whom are absolutely dominating wrestlers. Brooks is a better wrestler when he hits the mat. He's a better control wrestler and a better control grappler. But is he way better than Oliveira at getting those fights, getting the fight there and keeping it there?
I think he's way more technical, but the size difference.
Yeah, the size difference can cancel a lot of that out. So I'm looking at this fight as what could be an extended cage grappling battle, in which these two guys are pressing each other up against the fence constantly. Neither guy able to get takedowns. Neither guy comfortable or confident staying way outside at range and keeping the fight there. And it could just be an ugly mess. Now, I'm going to pick Brooks to win it because I think he's a better athlete who can offer a more technical game in these positions. But Alex Oliveira is a really good clinch fighter. Like, really solid inside dirty boxer and clinch fighter who makes fights hell there. So I'm not expecting Will Brooks to come out of this looking great, even if I think he can get the win.
I do think of Will Brooks as kind of a new generation of slicksters. We don't really have that style of fighting very much in MMA. Like, that's like the classic American boxing style, you know, like guys like Sweet Pea, like Pernell Whitaker, and like Floyd Mayweather, and like George Benton. Will Brooks, the style is not quite the same, but I think he is a lot like those guys in that he fights fairly cautiously. He's got a style that's like perfectly made for 5-round fights, and that's the trouble, because I think Will Brooks, to me, could definitely be a champion in this division. I think he is that talented. I think he has that skill set, and I think he's getting better fight by fight. I think he's still improving.
Yeah, I mean, he's not. His career is not that old for as much experience as he has. He's not been doing this that long.
Right, but he has a very difficult road of 3-round fights to get there, to get to the point where he can have 5-round fights. And unlike those guys in boxing who start off their career in like the least amount of rounds they'll have is 4, against really garbage opponents, and by the time a boxer is fighting respectable opposition, it's 6, 8, 10 rounds. Will Brooks has maximum 1.5 rounds to figure his opponent out because he's not a finisher. So he can't rely on putting them away in the third round. And so I think that means that Will Brooks could totally have a close fight with Ross Pearson, but in 5 rounds could probably beat Khabib Nurmagomedov. I think that's how one or the other it is with a fighter of that type. I think Pat on Heavy Hands said that he is like an updated version of Benson Henderson. And yeah. I think that's a pretty good comparison. Like, Ben Henderson was a difficult champion to take the belt away from, even though he didn't always dominate the fight because he kind of made you look dumb and he knew how to win rounds. And Will Brooks has that, but with a little bit crisper and more diverse striking and with a little more punishing clinch game. And, you know, I think his style of fighting is even a little more designed to kind of make you look bad. Like, he knows to hit you just after you miss or just when you look like you're getting frustrated. He's got a good grasp of that stuff. And I agree with you, though. Alex Oliveira in 3 rounds is a tough fight for Will Brooks. Alex Oliveira is a lightweight almost in name only. He has 4 UFC fights as a welterweight and only 2 at 155 pounds. And he has never looked small for the welterweight division. In fact, he looks big. He was bigger than Donald Cerrone when they fought at welterweight. And so he's going to come in here as a much larger lightweight than Will Brooks. And Brooks is also very good in the clinch. He's got a good takedown game. He's good on the ground. But you got to wonder how well his grappling expertise will play against a guy who's that much bigger than him. And Oliveira seems very strong. I think he strikes me as a fighter who gets away with a lot of bad technique on the ground because – you know, his game is limited, but he is very physically imposing. And so if he gets on top of you, he will beat the tar out of you and take your back when you try to get away. You got to pick Will Brooks. I think I almost feel compelled to pick him because, like, all around, he is the better fighter. He has a better skill set. He's not as easy to hit. He's a lot more skilled on the ground. And I think he has more nuance to his game in the clinch. And he is himself a phenomenal athlete. But if the fight gets ugly, and it totally could, then Alex Oliveira could win here. My secret hope is that Will Brooks was really trying to put on a show in his UFC debut against Ross Pearson, that he got that fight on like 4 weeks' notice or whatever. And he's like, all right, these people don't respect me as a Bellator champ. I'm going to come in here against another striker and have a fun-ass striking match. I think that's what he intended to do. But on the other side of that coin, I always hate when people use that as an excuse. People use it as an excuse for Golovkin, like, oh, he knew he didn't have to take this guy seriously. I'm like, well, that's not good if he's not taking all of his opponents seriously. So,
yeah, I don't tend to believe that kind of thing at all. I mean, it smacks too much of Holly Holm sandbagging. And like, oh, you didn't know she had this in her arsenal. It's like, okay, well, we didn't know that Ronda Rousey was going to be that terrible a matchup. But then you get to Misha Tate, and it's like, see, this is still like, is she sandbagging it against Misha Tate too in a title defense?
Yeah, no. When she turned back into normal Holly Holm because of the style matchup. Yeah, it turns style matchups into like a conspiracy theory where it's like, oh, no, he actually isn't this bad or whatever. But I think it does happen. I think fighters do like to put on shows.
Yeah, it reminds me a lot of his performances against guys like Dave Jansen, though, where, you know, he's winning. He's listlessly winning a fight that he's close to losing.
Yeah.
That is what I think of a lot with Will Brooks.
I think you have Will Brooks. If he were to get to the title in the UFC, he would have a lot of close rounds 1, 2, and 3, and he would have a lot of dominant rounds 4 and 5. That's why I think he is like an updated Ben Henderson, because rather than just having a close fight with everybody that he faces, he tends to get better and better as the fight goes on and better as his career goes on at knowing how to win those late rounds. So he's a fighter who relies on figuring you out and then playing your tendencies against you. And again, like 15 minutes is not a long time to do that.
No. So I'm expecting this to be a clinch-filled cage wrestling affair in which we see Brooks pressing Oliveira up against the fence, Oliveira pressing Brooks up against the fence, and neither guy finding a lot of purchase. That is what I expect to see.
I would love to see Brooks train a little with Dominic Cruz. I think he could make that weird footwork work really well, actually, because he's tireless and quick and likes to fight from long range. I'd like to see a little more kind of trickiness to his range striking game that I'm not sure he'll necessarily get at ATT.
Yeah, so Will Brooks currently is at favorite at minus 250 to minus 285, or to minus 300 rather, and Alex Oliveira plus 246 to plus 190. I don't want to say that that's steep, but like I say, I have some doubts about this fight. I'm seeing a split decision in my mind.
Yeah, I think it's a lot more likely that Oliveira makes Brooks look bad than it is that he beats him, though.
Yeah, it is. The odds are probably right, but this feels like a trap fight to me. This feels like a fight where everybody's like, oh, Brooks is going to go out there and just, you know, walk through this guy. He's a future champ. And it's like, yeah, but you actually have to watch how a lot of his fights go because he doesn't walk through many people. Mm-hmm. Really doesn't. And that brings us to our main event. John Lineker versus John Dodson.
Battle of Johns, battle of former flyweights. More, you get the sense, more inside jokes on the part of the matchmaking team at the UFC because they love to have just weird little narratives that go into these fights. So both of the guys who moved away from the flyweight division now get to fight as bantamweights. Both of them named John. I don't know if there's any other little lines that I'm missing, but I think this is a good fight. You said this before about who'd you say this about? Josh Burkman. That's how I feel about John Dodson. He frustrates the hell out of me. I know a lot of people really like him. A lot of people see him as like one of the few small guys who knocks people out. Although in the bantamweight division, he's no longer in more passive company. There's a lot of knockout punchers at bantamweight. But John Dodson to me is always a guy. He always frustrates me because I like fighters who have a clear process to what they're doing. I like fighters who are systematic. I like my favorite aha moments reviewing footage are when I see somebody set up a strike perfectly over several stages. When I see someone establish a threat, feint that threat, and then follow up with the perfect strike to capitalize on the opponent's misread. And John Dodson doesn't do that. It's like very aimless when he fights, very, very aimless. Very fast, very powerful. He can set traps if you chase him, but I get the sense a lot of times that he doesn't necessarily know what he's doing. It's like he'll see an opening, he can spring on it faster than almost anyone else, and you got to imagine that even as he gets older, he's going to be extremely quick at bantamweight because he was probably the fastest flyweight on the roster, faster in single bursts even than Demetrius Johnson. John Lineker's not a particularly fast bantamweight. And so I can definitely see John Dodson stopping John Lineker. Like, that is a possibility. If John Dodson walks away and Lineker comes forward, growing more and more confident that nobody can stop him once he corners them and just walks into a left hand, that could be it. You know, like, you have to knock John Lineker out and with decisive blows and then get away, or you've got to hit him with a clean shot and then get away. You have to frustrate him or you have to stop him if you're going to beat him on the feet. And Dodson
sounds a lot like John Dodson to me.
Yeah, sure. But John Dodson is like more frustrating to watch than he often is to fight. You know what I mean? It's not like he's in there. He's not Will Brooks. Like, he's not going to like hit you at the exact moment that it's worst to be hit. It's not going to be like, this is the time when you don't look like you're ready and it's going to exaggerate the shot and you're going to look stupid, or this is a perfectly timed reactive double leg and you're going to look like you can't stop a takedown to save your life. It's like the Zach Makovsky fight. It's like, what's he doing? He's just like kind of trading kicks with Zach Makovsky from long range and then staring at him for a minute at a time. No feints, no apparently methodical movement, no intentions to make the next thing happen. And John Lineker does that. You know, he's hittable, but he throws a lot of volume, possibly a little less powerful than Dodson, but certainly throws a lot more strikes and uses a variation of target and some pretty good pressuring footwork to set up everything that he wants to happen. Everything is geared towards what John Lineker wants to do to you, and he just keeps doing it until you can't take it anymore. And John Dodson gasses, and that is a big fear. You know, I don't know. I think John Lineker is the kind of guy who, if you have gas tank issues, he's going to bring them out. And John Dodson, I don't think can keep up his extremely athletic style of striking and moving for a long time. So I can definitely see John Dodson being the guy to knock out John Lineker, which would upset me so much because this is the first time I've picked John Lineker in a while, I think. No, I picked him over Michael McDonald.
Yeah, but you should have picked him over Michael McDonald. Yeah. That was like such an easy setup. I picked
Rob Font over him, though, which was a bad call. Although, hey, Rob Font, only bantamweight so far not to get finished by him. Had a few moments, but wasn't ready.
Yeah.
But John Dodson's not even as careful as Rob Font with that kind of – but he's a lot more powerful.
He's a lot more powerful. He's a lot faster.
This is going to be the time where I'm like, all right, guys, I'm sold. John Lineker, and I'm picking John Lineker, and John Dodson's going to spark him out in the first round. But I'm going with John Lineker by late TKO.
And I'm going with John Dodson. I hate to do it. I don't want to do it. But the thing with Lineker is that, you know, it's really all about you cracking – to what you cracking to his pressure. That's where Lineker lives.
It's like you try to scare him off or you try to get away and he's like Jason. Like he never moves quickly, but every time you look over your shoulder, he's right there.
And so the problem, you know, for a lot of fighters, they can't stay ahead eventually. They just can't. Some of them it's very quickly, they just can't. Dodson does not. Like, I don't feel Dodson has that problem. Like, we've seen Dodson in there against, you know, Demetrius Johnson. We've seen him in there against very good opponents. And he may kind of forget what he's doing. He may not have a clear process for how to go through the fight or to pick the right opportunities or any of that kind of thing. But I never get the feeling that Dodson is just getting so frustrated that he can't create or he can't fight the way he wants to fight. You know, I feel it, like it just feels very suited for him to, you know, Lineker will keep chasing him and Dodson will keep moving and Lineker will give these openings trying to flurry. And for, you know, every three of them, Dodson will find one and that'll be it. Like his
speed. How consistently can Dodson do that though? And how does Dodson deal with pressure fighters? Like he's not done well with Demetrius Johnson's pressure in both of their fights.
Yeah, but Demetrius Johnson is also worlds faster than John Lineker.
Faster, sure. But it's the fact that Dodson's like getting backed up. He doesn't look as comfortable. Like he likes this open space fight where he is free to do his aimless picking and choosing spots and kind of thing.
I just think that Lineker will give him too much of that open space. Like even trying to close him down will give him too much of that open space because he's not fast enough to close at the speed needed.
Yeah.
And that's,
I think this is the reason that I will probably pick Cody Garbrandt over John Lineker when they fight. I think he can probably do that. I just don't trust John Dodson, but
I know you don't like him.
I don't like him. It's not. Yeah. So don't take it seriously. Right. Like I probably would pick him if I like, and I don't like Cody Garbrandt either. So, yeah. But
it's just one of those, like I see Dodson fighting and here's the thing that gives me pause.
Yeah.
Is that Dodson can be hit hard by single shots. Mm-hmm. He will leave himself open to it. He will stand and watch and try and close at the wrong time and get hit clean by single shots. But he's tough and really hard to hurt. And he's very good at not getting hit twice. You know, you hit him once and he will burst back out into open space and restart the whole process over.
Yeah.
And the fact that Lineker, for as good a puncher as he is not the most crushing one-punch puncher.
Yeah.
That makes me feel like even when Lineker can pressure, even when he can find those right shots to land, Dodson will be able to get back out into open space and reset and start this process over.
He relies on you being unable to get away or on you feeling like you have to stand your ground for too long.
And I don't think that those are problems that Dodson faces. I don't feel like that's something that traps him.
You may be right. The southpaw could help too, because they have a little more space than most other guys do.
Yeah. So I don't want to pick John Dodson, but I am picking John Dodson.
You make me want to pick John Dodson now, but I've already picked Lineker on both heavy hands and my Sherdog preview, so now I have to stick with it.
I know. I'm sorry.
Oh.
If he wins, if Dodson wins, I will be extra sorry. Understand this.
Oh, I'll be sorry because it'll be the first time that I've picked against John Lineker, or I've picked for John Lineker and he hasn't won. It's just like I'm going to pick Conor McGregor over Eddie Alvarez probably, and that'll be the one time I bank on Conor McGregor and he doesn't freaking win.
Let me put it this way. I'd much rather be in your shoes being wrong about John Lineker than being in my shoes and being wrong about Anthony Hamilton. I will pick every Anthony Hamilton fight wrong for the end of time until the
end. Is that your thing? Did you pick him over Abdurakhimov?
I did. I'm pretty sure. Oh, yeah.
God. All right. I feel a little better now, Zane. Thank you for that.
I picked every Anthony Hamilton fight wrong. Every single one. He wins every time I think he'll lose. He'll lose every time I think he wins.
I mean, in fairness, you watch one loss of his, and you're like, this guy will never win. Then you watch him win, and you watch him win, and you don't really know why it happened. So you're like, yep. I guess.
Yeah. It's
very difficult to read.
It is. On that note, John Dodson is the favorite, -111 to -130. John Lineker is the underdog, +113 to -111. So these lines are very close. I believe Dodson deserves to be the favorite.
I'm kind of surprised that he is, though. Because Lineker definitely has the momentum in this division.
He definitely has the hype and the momentum behind him. I don't think there's any bet to be made on this fight.
Yeah.
At all.
I think it's a little too close.
And not even like a finish bet, because both dudes are tough and durable, and Dodson's fast enough that if he just decides, you know what, fuck it, I'm just going to stay outside and cool my heels and try not to get hurt, he could do that.
What about over 2.5 at -125?
No, not against with guys who have this kind of power.
Like, so what about under 2.5 at -105?
None of it sounds good.
Yeah, it's all a little too close.
It's all too close. There's too many options. There's too much power at stake. And these fighters are experienced enough that I don't expect either of them to fail miserably, but I could see either of them finishing instantly too.
Yeah, and I think it all hinges on Dodson. Like, Dodson could turn this into an awful fight and win, an awful fight and lose, or he could go for a really quick finish and win, or go for a really quick finish and lose. Because we know exactly what Lineker is going to do.
Yeah. Lineker's going to stalk forward, look for his openings, and the moment you give him openings, he will try and hurt you bad enough to knock you out.
Yeah.
That's it.
Hopefully it's fun and not shitty.
Yeah, I hope it's not just Dodson lose. I hope it's not Dodson losing an awful fight. That would be the worst to me, because Dodson winning an awful fight to me suggests he'd probably be like out-grappling Lineker and out-working him on the ground and something like that. And
I don't want to see Dodson wrestle with Lineker.
Yeah, and I could stand that much better than I could stand to see Dodson just losing this patient outfighting.
That's true. I would like to see Dodson win a fight that isn't exciting if it has like a game plan.
Yeah, exactly.
Because that's the reason that I don't often get up for John Dodson's fights.
All right. On that note, I'm going to close the show. You can find me on Twitter at TheZaneSimon. You can find Connor on Twitter at BoxingBush. That's BUSCH. You can find both of us over at BloodyElbow.com. If you're watching this video over on YouTube, give it a like. That's the thumbs up. And you better be watching this on YouTube, because that's where we're broadcasting it.
If you're not, you have stolen it. Please return this video immediately. Can I name the bets that I've made before we go?
Oh, yeah. Give us a couple bets before I close this out.
Yeah, I bet on Cody East at plus 185. I think that line's a little wide. Heavyweight bet, take it with a grain of salt. I also bet on that fight $3 to go over 1.5 rounds. I think that's pretty likely. I bet on Nate Marquardt at plus 180 because I can really see him knocking Tamdan McCrory out. I bet on another heavyweight fight because I'm an idiot, Shamil Abdurakhimov. I think minus 115 is way too close for a fight with a guy who has only one very surprising win in the UFC. And I bet on Moreno versus Smolka to last less than 1.5 rounds at plus 140. I think at underdog odds, the chances of Smolka just running over Moreno are pretty decent.
All right, there you have it. Give this or subscribe to MMANation.com. That's where you see all the rest of our shows, interviews, analysis, all that good stuff. We'll be I'll be back for a sixth round after the fights, joined by Eddie Mercado. Nate's out this week. And then we'll be back next week to gear up for UFC 204, watching the weirdness that is Michael Bisping defend a middleweight title. So
against Dan Henderson. You can't not include the challenger, because that's half of the reason it's so weird.
That's honestly, though, any idea of Michael Bisping defending a middleweight title is just really weird.
Yeah.
So join us for that. We'll be back. Vivisection, care, don't care, sixth round, heavy hands, all that good stuff. Thanks everyone for tuning in. We'll see you next time.